Mission given to me by Woody Shaw, Sunship, Dizzy, and Billy Higgins, dedicated to pursuing a piece of our cultural heritage through interviews with my jazz heroes. This is the Jake Feinberg Show. Welcome to a special edition of the Jake Feinberg Show. And as I've traversed the musical landscape of the late 60s and early 70s, it was the confluence of Motown, Hollywood, and a plethora of studio work that lent itself to creating versatile and compelling musicians and bands in Southern California. Some, like my guest today, didn't start out in LA but wound up there. He was born in Houston, Texas. It was from a family of 17. 15 of which were sisters. He began playing tenor saxophone with boyhood friends Joe Sample, Styx Hooper, and Wayne Henderson. Collectively, this group took the blues-based saturation of Texas and melded that with the gospel and soul from the church. They took this gut-bucket approach on the road, originally as the Nighthawks, but eventually wound up in the aforementioned sunny California, where they became the outfit known as the Jazz Crusaders. By 1970, the group was the first to pivot from soul jazz to a more fusion-based sound with driving marching band horns and lots of improvisational funk. My guest had at that point started playing the bass and became the most in-demand session player of the time. Donald Byrd, Joni Mitchell, Sam Neely, Marvin Gaye, Pacific Gas and Electric, Steely Dan, Seals and Crofts, Michael Omartian, and Grant Green. One of the most unheralded players of the last half century. Wilton Felder, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Glad to be here.
I played that clip right off the bat for you. Did you recognize any of that?
Yes.
Do tell.
Yes, I did.
What was it?
The one that you played the music?
Exactly.
No, I didn't recognize that one.
You know, that was 1973, Donald Byrd, The Little Rosty.
Okay. Wow, that went way back.
But Wilton, that's the Wilton, man. That sound, that was an explosive sound, man. It was Ed Green, you know, your rhythm buddy, and the track that I played was Joe Sample was on that album, you know, and you guys just were having such a good time in there, man. I mean, it sounds great. You really are, man, a huge, you know, for a lot of my generation that didn't get a chance to see the Crusaders live, that didn't get a chance to see jazz, certain types of jazz live. You're definitely, you guys are heroes to my generation. That's why I'm doing this.
Okay. Well, appreciate it.
How did you develop your chops early on? Did you do a lot of practicing in the garage? Did you have a lot of opportunities to play live? What ways did you work on that?
Are you talking about bass chops?
Both, horn and bass.
Okay. Well, the horn came when I started playing in junior high school, and then, of course, practicing and working live with the band in high school and then junior high, and then coming out to California and gigging. So that was my experience there. But on the bass, actually a clubber gave me a bass and I learned to play the bass by myself.
Who gave you the bass?
A club owner.
A club owner?
Harry Lieberman.
Right.
Where Joe was playing organ, and so he got tired of playing organ, and so I started playing bass. And I taught myself how to play the bass, and I got in the recording studio by a guy by the name of Ron Brown. I substituted for him once for a Motown date, and a guy by the name of Barrett, he called me back for some more sessions, and that's how I got into the recording industry and playing bass.
I know, but I want to go back to this idea. How did you learn to, or what were the ways that you went about educating yourself on the bass?
Well, actually, like I said, I was self-taught, mm-hmm. and I really didn't look at the study books of how to mm-hmm. hear properly. I just developed my own style of playing, what worked for me.
Yeah, that is a very simplistic response. I mean, I guess what I'm trying to say is, it was totally a natural gift. Music was a gift given to you. Is that's fair to say?
Yes.
And growing up in your house, Wayne Henderson told me you had 15 sisters. Is that true?
Not quite 15. It was 15 of us. I'm the 13th one. I'm the baby of the family.
You're the baby of the family. So, how much time did you spend growing up playing for your family?
Well, I guess about maybe 6 of the years before we left to come out to California.
What did you learn? I mean, did they give you a lot of feedback and give you a lot of encouragement? I mean, that's just a huge family. You don't see those kinds of family. I have four in my family, two kids. I mean, that's pretty much what you see now. That's like four families today.
Yeah, well, actually, all of them weren't living at home. Some of them had already passed away when I came up. I only knew 7 of them. But a few of them had died before. And my brother was instrumental in giving me my saxophone. I had pneumonia, and he gave me a horn. He said if I got well, he would give me the horn. So I got well, and so he started me off on the saxophone. So he always encouraged me.
And then I'm just trying to get this idea of, you know, becoming comfortable in front of playing in front of a lot of people. How did that come about naturally? Like once you started to get together with Joe and Wayne and sticks, or just because of the large family, was there always music in the house?
There was always music in the house, and actually Joe lived right around the corner from me, and so I played music in junior high school, and also when I got to high school, I played music together, so I've always been in front of an audience.
So talk about, you know, meeting the guys and how quickly that was. I mean, you were a veritable youngster, but when you met them, how did you guys, it fell right into sync right away?
No. Actually, when I joined the band had five saxophone players. And
five.
It whittled down to just me.
wait, they had five saxophonists?
Five saxophonists when I came, and then it whittled down to me. But what happened was that all the other guys were all actually sweetly. I was the youngest one coming from Yo Smith, and they were all in the marching band. I met the guys, they were already in the band, and I didn't meet Joe until I came to senior high with Ann, and then that's when I met Wayne as well. But Joe had actually lived around the corner from me, but I didn't meet him until I got to senior high school. But Wayne had already met him.
Wayne had met him?
Right. Wayne's family and had a cousin that lived right next door to Joe. And so Joe and Wayne had met as youngsters. But we had, when the group was being formed, before Joe got in the band, there was a keyboardist by the name of Alvis Harvey. And then Joe took his place, and then we whittled it down to the Modern Jazz Sextet, which was Hubert Laws, myself, Wayne, Joe Sticks, and a bass player by the name of Henry Wilson.
That was the, I'm familiar with that group at all. I didn't even know you, so you guys did collaborate in a band with Hubert Laws before you guys, I mean, I know he played on like Chili Con Sol, you know, like that beautiful Latin album you did, but
yes.
I always got this impression that he went East Coast and you went West Coast, but you guys were actually in a band together.
Yes, we were in Houston together. Wayne and Hubert lived in the same area, Studewood Heights.
In the wards, yeah.
But Hubert left. We all came out to California together. But Hubert won a scholarship to Juilliard, and he left and went to New York. That's why he didn't record with us when we first began the band.
I see.
And that's why he only recorded with us on the Chili Con Sol album. But when we were in Houston, we were known as the Modern Jazz Sextet, and Hubert was a part of that. And Hubert was actually playing in the clubs with us when Joe was playing organ.
Now, when you say the clubs, that's the Modern Jazz Quartet?
The Modern Jazz Sextet. But when we were doing club gigs, we were like called the Nighthawks.
That's right. So when you were doing Nighthawk stuff, Hubert was playing flute.
He was playing flute and tenor. I mean, flute and alto.
Right.
And I was playing tenor and bassoon.
You know, for my audience, Wilton, it's hard. Like I hear about you hear about the Nighthawks. You hear they were an R&B band, but R&B in the earlier sense, not the sweet, not the electronic soul, but. How did the horns, how would you describe the sound of the Nighthawks?
The sound of the Nighthawks was regular dance music. You know, the clubs were where people dance and they were entertained. So we were playing the songs of the day, and it was just like a regular band.
Right. For some reason, though, and there were no
vocals.
There
guys like Nappy Brown, the you know, and other people. So it's like a different band, like the average band.
Wilton, talk to me about, I don't know their names offhand, but I mean, you were on that heavy blues circuit in Texas, and you met a lot of older guys, mentors to you, I would assume, maybe not, guys that you just, what did you learn from the generation before you when you were in that circuit?
Well, I learned what it felt like to really play the blues. Being that the guitarist had amps and stuff, I didn't have an amp, so I had to learn how to play over live guitars. So I learned to use a metal mouthpiece. But the experience of playing with the those guys was really great. In fact, we would have jam sessions at the Club Ebony and at the Matinee, and then like B.B. King's band would come in, and you would be surprised that you would think that these guys only could play blues, but these guys were like great jazz players as well.
Really?
Yes.
I mean, that's confounding. That's unbelievable.
Let's play Cherokee. So you got taught real good, and a guy that played with Ray Charles, a tenor player by the name of Don Wilkinson.
Yeah, I do. The name rings a mild bell.
Okay, well, this guy was so bad that every time that I would come to town, he just lay for me, and every time I played, he'd come up on a bandstand and just chew me up. So that just made me work harder.
Now, let me go back to something you said before. Talk about how things got whittled down from five saxophonists to Wilton Felder.
this was a tryout stage when they were trying to figure out the band. And so that was a few tenor players that were sort of, you know, playing something around high school. And so they each came in to try out. And so as they tried out, and then they whittled out the ones.
But they were going for a larger sound, sort of a marching band kind of sound, and then all of a sudden it was realized, well, Wilton's got so much fire, soul, he has the output of five guys in one, or it just became more of a soul jazz conglomerate?
Well, it really, in the beginning, it was like looking for a saxophone player and a piano player. So, when Elvis Harvey was the first piano player, and then that's when we had the more saxophones. And then when Joe came, it was down to two, and then finally it was down to one.
Well, for my audience, you know, they could listen to Jay Feinberg ask Wilton questions, but we might as well get down into brass tacks and play a little bit of and hear Wilton's tenor playing, phenomenal tenor player. And I have to remind myself sometimes of that, Wilton, because, you know, I mean, everything that you have, all the bass stuff you did, it's just incredible. But let's check out some of this tenor stuff and we'll smoke them, okay?
Okay. Thank you.
That was 1975, you know, live show from the Roxy. You know, what is that? Can you go back in that during that time period and describe it? Because I look back, you know, I guess the way I want to set up the question is, you know, the Jazz Crusaders were in the 60s, and the 60s were a real, you know, you saw a lot of progress and a lot of movement, and it was a happy time, and your albums reflect that in a soul jazz way. But you guys turned real hard to, like I said in my opening, you guys were pretty heavy fusion jazz blues band, and take me back to that time period and tell me what you guys were, how you were doing.
Well, when we first started off, we started playing more or less the West Coast style of jazz and also with the East Coast style of jazz, but our natural roots of the Gulf Coast, we were not really expressing. And so I think it was the album Tough Talk, when we first used Joe used the clavinet, and we played a song called Tough Talk.
Yes.
I think that was the beginning of our expressing our Gulf Coast sound. And then when Joe started playing electric piano, even when no one else was playing electric piano, that's when we started going into what they categorized as like more fusion or whatever.
Or whatever. I mean, oh man. I just want to go back. You said Joe Sample, first one to be using the electric keyboard before anybody else?
Yes.
Wow, that's I mean,
any of the other jazzers, we got condemned for him playing that kind of piano.
You know, it seems to me that you know, it was kind of a right place, right time, but Wayne Henderson said a lot of people were going after that Texas, that Gulf Coast sound after you guys hit it really hard. I mean, was it a totally subconscious thing? Did you realize you obviously could hear it was, the sound was different. But how did you guys fundamentally change psychologically as you went into that?
Well, it was how we felt. And the music just indicated where we were feeling at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
And each song was engendered of what the movement, what we were feeling at the moment. I think that what really made the sound different was you heard normally tenor and trumpet, but the sound between Wayne and I, both tenor and trombone, sounding like one instrument, made the difference in the sound of the Crusaders. And of course, with Joe and Styx, the feeling was different.
Max Bennett showed up on this one. He played bass, and it always confused me. I said, you know, I'm like, there's no way Wilton could be playing bass and tenor sax. What, is he playing bass in one hand and tenor in the other? You know, but it turns out you guys had a variety of bass players during that time.
Yes, well, Max Bennett played live with us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when we were using electric bass. But in the earlier days, we had stand-up bass.
Right, and I interviewed my first Crusader that I ever interviewed was Bobby Haynes.
Yes, that was he was the second bassist that we used on the first album that we did of Freedom Sound.
Yeah.
That was a studio musician that was used. Jimmy Bond was the first bass player that recorded with us. And then Bobby Haynes was the next one. And then Victor Gaskin.
Of course. What about, you liked Max Bennett live? So, because of the electric bass. So you were playing in the 70s, though. Talk a little bit about locally, Southern California, the kind of live gigs you would play, and were you ever doing stand-up bass, or was it just an electric set?
Okay, I never played stand-up bass. The live gigs in California Wall was like at the lighthouse, somewhere else like that, a concert by the sea. And so I can't play bass and saxophone at the same time. So I've never played bass live. I only played bass in the studio, and when we recorded, I started playing bass with us only because the bass players couldn't seem to feel what was needed. And so finally Joe said to me, why don't you play it yourself? So I started playing bass with the Crusaders.
Okay, so, but see, so you were playing bass, and then at that point, not playing tenor at that point.
Well, I was playing tenor as well. I think from the Crusader 1 album on, I started playing the bass because we had been trying to get the bass players to play what was necessary. Joe and I were both doing studio work, and so since I was doing studio work playing bass with all these other people, when it came down to certain songs that we wanted to play and have a certain feel, we couldn't get it. So Joe said to, well, why don't you play it? So I started playing bass, and then I would have to open up my horn.
Wow. It's, you know, it is still a little bit of a, if you went on a tour, I have a show from 1973, right in that time period from Seattle, and you're playing horn exclusively. So if you went on a tour, you'd take Max with you.
Yes.
And Max was originally from the Stan Kenton Band. Is that correct?
I think so.
Yeah, and he, you know, fundamentally, how do you try? You can't create that kind of spiritual energy that you guys build on that music. And how would you describe what is in your mind? What is in your mind when you're playing this kind of music? Or is there anything at all, or is it just you're just playing your butt off?
Well, it's like, it's always been, for me, it's like each one contributing to like a painting. Mm-hmm. So whatever Wayne left off playing, I would try to go somewhere else. And I would be building off of what Joe would be doing.
Right. It's called listening. I think it's called listening.
Yes.
And the idea is that when you listen, you're just saying, okay, this is what this person is doing, and I want to fill in over here and make it a little more colorful.
That's a good picture of it.
After 150 interviews, Wilton, I hope I got it down by now.
Yeah.
One cat that I wanted to talk to you about, somebody that you're the first one that I've, maybe the second one that I've interviewed who had an opportunity to collaborate with Grant Green. And I was just wondering how much you did and what was that experience like?
It was a great experience. I only think I did one album with him.
Oh, yeah, you don't worry about that. We're about to cue that up.
Okay, but I never got a chance to play with him live. But I did one thing with him in the studio.
No, Wilton, this, what I'm about to play you is a live performance from the Lighthouse that came out on Blue Note. Well, you just have to listen. Can we listen to it and we'll come back?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Let's do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to welcome you to the Lighthouse on behalf of Blue Note Records. We're very glad that you're here to share this unified vibrational tribute to this live session. My name is Ed Hamilton. We're here for a live session for Blue Note Records. We want to introduce the group for those who aren't familiar. On Conghettos, we have Miss Bobby Hall. On drums, we have Mr. Greg Williams on drums. On the Hammond organ, we have a good brother from Springfield, Massachusetts. His name is Shelton Laster. very dynamic brother on Fender bass from Crusaderville. His name is Wilton Felder. Woo! Another electrifying brother on tenor saxophone, Claude Barty from Indianapolis. Gary Coleman on vibraphones. Let him have a great round of applause also, because he's gonna lend in on the vibraphones. Mr. Grant Green, recording live for Blue Note at the Lighthouse.
Live 1972 from the Lighthouse.
Wow.
That's great, man. You know, and for you, I mean, you weren't part of the quartet, so they, I mean, Grant handpicked you to come in and play for that.
Yes.
I mean, that's something to be pretty, I mean, how did you feel about that at the time? Were you just happy to fill up the calendar with work? Or looking back on it, maybe in retrospect, do you realize how amazing that is, or is that commonplace?
No, well, that was amazing that I was being able to come in and play with him on bass, you know.
Exactly. I mean, when was the last, had you ever played with him before?
No, that was the first time.
And, that was one of the more, you know, can you talk about, especially in the studio sense, or they were making, Blue Note was making a live recording, how do you stay in the pocket? Why is it important as a bass player to stay in the pocket? And like, for instance, with Grant there, how did you stay in that pocket?
Well, it's, first of all, it's knowing what the position of a bass player is. The bass player is supposed to be, for me, is supplying the rhythm and the bottom end, and listening to what's going on around you, not being the solo instrument. So the groove that was going on, it was me to just keep it pumping like everybody else was doing.
So your mentality is to make make everybody else sound better, or make that lead person sound as good as possible. And that's what Ron Carter told me. We had an interesting conversation, but what he really said, he goes, my job as a bass player is to make sure that the people around me, and most importantly the leader, sounds really good.
That's true.
And I think that's what lends itself to him being on over 3,000 albums. Wilton, honestly, have you spent time thinking about, or have you categorized how many albums you've actually played on?
No, I haven't counted all the ones that we played on.
Have people?
But I haven't counted them all.
You know, it was just it was happening at that period of time on the East Coast and the West Coast. But I think the really one of the more magical things just must have been the next track I want to play for you is. Total going to be coming out of left field. But again, I have a feeling it was another cold call to have Wilton Felder drop some bombs on bass. So let's take a listen. Thank you.
do it.
I appreciate you sitting through that. You know, I'll tell you every day I live in this on this street with a lot of rolling hills, and I push my 3-month-old daughter up and down those hills listening to that stuff. I mean, that is ferocious. That do you have any idea what that was?
I don't remember the name of the song, but I think that was that Chickaree.
No, did you ever play with Chick?
I did a recording. I did a recording with either Herbie or Chick at his studio, Mad Hatter.
This was quite a bit earlier, 1972. And John Klemmer, Mike Knock, and Eddie Marshall, and Victor Feldman on percussion. So it was a John Klemmer album called Waterfalls.
Okay.
Dude, Will, you're not even, it doesn't even register. I just think it's one of the
things. Okay, well, I know I played with John Klemmer on Touch, and so the one Waterfall I've forgotten about.
I just want to tell you that you and Eddie Marshall and Victor Feldman were, everyone was on fire. On fire!
Yeah.
Dude, I mean, that, again, there were this club called, let's see, it says 1972, the Ash Grove. And Diana Lee on vocals. And those two tunes were called There's Some Light Ahead and Centrifugal Force. But... You know, like, did you get a chance to play? I mean, Eddie Marshall was more of a Bay Area guy, and that was in Southern California where you were based. Did you get a chance to play with Eddie a lot?
No, not a lot.
So when you guys would come together, you know, at a session like this, you know, you get together, you don't really know each other. Is it just like the less said, the better? Let's go out and just play? I mean, you don't go out of your way to try to bond with them emotionally in order to create better music.
It was just more or less coming together and doing it. You know, I hadn't played like a whole long time with them, but, you know, we just came and like had a rehearsal and did it.
You would have a rehearsal prior to, though?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I was going to say, because then it takes off. What do you, when you hear that music, I don't hear that music in today's society at all. It's a much more stratified, safe. That was pretty avant-garde stuff. I mean, you can call that fusion, but you know, you look at the guys that were the freedom within the industry to be able to bring in the best, and to be able to put out great music. That's what resonates with me, is the energy and the power, because as far as I'm concerned, money was not a massively corrupting influence. Too much money is a massively corrupting influence.
The power is in the musicians themselves. You know, if a guy plays with fire, you match him. If he doesn't play with fire, you try to motivate him, and if you can't motivate him, well, then that's what you get.
Talk about a situation how do you motivate somebody, and what are some of the tricks? I mean, how many times are you going to go into your bag of tricks before you say this guy's just not going to get it?
Well, you can hear a guy play, and you can know if the guy can play or not.
Yeah,
and you can see where you can go and how much you can push and what you can't do, but usually. You try to surround yourself with musicians that can really play and that you can add something to it.
Who were the cats? I mean, I kind of know the answers, but for my audience, who were the guys that you were consistently bumping into at these, whether it was at, Pacific Jazz or even after that, Blue Thumb, Impulse, Blue, wherever you were going, who were some of the guys that they would... that you would always run into in the studio scene?
In the studio scene, it would always be guys like, let's see. You mean in the jazz side?
Anything, you know? I mean, who are the guys that, you know, the jack of all, I mean, Wilton, just like Jimmy Madison, the drummer on the that from New York, and Herb Bushler, and all these guys, you guys were jack of all trades. I mean, what we know now in my generation as styles or idioms of music, it didn't exist back then. You just did your gig. And
yeah.
there was a group, there was a cadre on the East Coast, and there was a cadre on the West Coast. And then I just want to know who those guys were that were the jack of all trades.
Okay, it would be people like Grover. It would be people like Richard T.
Mm-hmm.
Marcus Miller. Turrentine.
Right. Well, I'm talking more about like the
sections.
Yeah. Well, like for instance, like you and Ed Green. I mean, like I interviewed Ed. Ed before. You know.
Well, I would do. It would be Ed Green, David T. Walker,
King Harrison.
Yeah, and that would be. Let's see. Ray Parker.
Mm-hmm.
That would be Donald Fagan. That would be
maybe John Guerin and a few other guys as well, but Gary Coleman, Bobby Hall, the Harvey Masons, and then there were, at that time, it was quite confounding. You guys moved out to California, and then Motown came in. Were you doing stuff with Motown when they were still in Detroit, or did you become their bass player, or one of their bass players once they came out to California?
Well, when I came out to California, I didn't play bass until I came out to California.
Mm-hmm.
And I got into the recording scene, and then there was Clive Davis.
Mm-hmm.
That they had a place, studio down here with Motown, and that my first recording was like on a Commodore's record.
Yeah, right, and so you must have been working more than you even possibly, and then you made your own album on World Pacific called Bullitt, B-U-L-L-I-T-T.
Yes.
Talk a little bit about that. That's an expense. That's a $40 album. It's hard to get my. I've never been able to get my hands on it. I've never seen a copy of it. Talk about how that came about.
Well, that came about after the movie Bullitt came out. That was my very first solo album. And so we just did the all the songs from the album itself. And I didn't do any of the writing, but I just did, you know, the playing on it. And that was decided to be my first solo album.
Did Richard Bach allow you to choose the musicians you wanted to play with? Or were you with the
No, he just got the ones together and put the band together.
But he wanted to give an album with you as the leader on it. He really wanted to promote you.
Yes.
Because it wasn't like you said, you didn't write a lot of the compositions, or you didn't write any of the compositions, but yet he wanted to put you out front. Talk about Richard Bach briefly, because, I mean, you know, I've talked to George Duke and John Hurd and, you know, guys that dealt with him, and he was, you know, everyone to a T, I mean, they respected him. He wasn't a perfect person, but, you know, he understood, what did he understand about the West Coast music scene at that time that made him a cut above everybody else?
Well, I think that he recognized that we had something to say, and that the West Coast musicians had talent that should be out there, even though it wasn't like the East Coast sound. Actually, Curtis Amy, the tenor player,
yes,
introduced us to Dick Bach.
Sure.
And he recognized that we had something going on, and he gave us an opportunity to express ourselves, to be ourselves, and he was always had his ears open to, you know, give persons a lift up.
I'm gonna just one thing here. When you say we had something to say, we had something going on, could you, for my audience, be just give a few specifics of what you mean by that?
Well, I remember when we first. Curtis told Dick that he should hear us, and he came over to Joe's house we did an audition, and we played a couple of songs, and after we had played a couple of songs, he said that we had a contract to come in and, you know, to cut a cup to become recording artists. After
he
heard us play.
Wow. Curtis Amy, a total unsung hero.
Yeah.
And did Curtis wind up, did he wind up ever playing on albums with you guys?
No, Curtis never played with us. But he was the one instrumental in getting us in touch with Big Bach. Richard Bach.
And Wilton, you know, we've gone over an hour. You've been kind enough to take some time here. I wanted to end our interview, at least this part of it, with a song, and come back, say goodbye, okay?
Okay.
Now the walls took a long time to crumble, and the jumbled pieces of my life way around to come together.
Pretty cool.
Yes.
That was Nancy Wilson.
Yes.
And I think one of the cooler concepts that, you know, about the Crusaders, Wilton, is that, you know, Nancy wanted to do an album and she said, I just want to bring in the rhythm section. And so Wayne wasn't on that album, but Styx, Joe, and you were playing were her backup band, essentially. Beautiful.
Yes, she's an excellent lady.
So, Wilton, I want to ask you right now, before we go, tell me a little bit about what you're doing, how you're staying busy, and are you playing a lot of, are you doing a lot of different stuff, or are you just staying with the Jazz Crusaders?
Right now, I'm just staying with the Jazz Crusaders. I'm just playing tenor more so now than bass.
You're playing a lot more saxophone because you're going back to the more 60s style stuff.
Yes.
Right. All right. Wilton, it was an honor to talk to you, and I look forward to doing it again in the future.
Okay, I look forward to it.